This morning I want to talk about the Lord's Prayer. And you've probably heard a dozen sermons over the years on the Lord's Prayer. While it seems like prayer is kind of pretty simple, it's actually one of the more demanding tasks of the Christian life. I don't know about you, but at times I have found prayer boring, frustrating, confusing. One thing I've learned is it does not work to simply say your prayers. Real prayer, the kind of prayer that the Bible talks about, is really tough work, hard business. And where was it when Jesus sweat drops of blood? Where was that? When he was in the garden, and what was he doing? He was praying. Interesting, not when he's on trial in front of Pilate or Caiaphas, not when he's threatened with death by the crowds that are yelling, crucify him. Not when he's carrying his cross. He's not sweating blood. He sweat blood as he was praying in the garden. I think any of us who had been there with him would have been worried about him. I mean, that's not supposed to happen, is it? Sweating blood? That's serious. Yet somehow, when he was done with that prayer, with that prayer time, Jesus walked confidently to the cross while all the disciples except John abandoned him. Makes me wonder, what did Jesus know about prayer that maybe we don't know? In the Sermon on the Mount, right after Jesus said, don't pray like the Pharisees who get up front and just kind of go on and use flowery language and want to be heard. Right after he said that, the disciples asked Jesus a very logical question. That they said, then how should we pray? And when they asked that question, you have to think about it. The disciples had already been with Jesus for about 2 years by that point. They had front row seats to everything Jesus had done. They had watched him do miracles, heal hundreds of people. They had no doubt heard him pray many times. And yet they said, Lord, teach us how to pray. And so what Jesus did was he gave them a little poem. He gave them a poem. And Jesus carefully chose the words in his poem, not for their rhyming value, but to remind them of who they were praying to and what their responsibilities and rights were as children of God. Jesus gave his disciples a poem to memorize and then to repeat over and over again. A poem that would rehearse the values that he was trying to teach them and reinforce their beliefs. Poetry actually does that. Good poetry reinforces things. I want to play you 90 seconds of a poem from quite a few years ago. See if you recognize it.
A long, long time ago, I can still remember how that music used to make me smile. And I knew if I had my chance that I could make those people dance and maybe they'd be happy for a while. But February made me shiver with every paper I'd deliver. Bad news on the doorstep, I couldn't take one more step. I can't remember if I cried when I read about his widowed bride, but something touched me deep inside the day the music died. So bye bye, Miss American Pie. Drove my Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry. And them good old boys were drinking whiskey and rye, singing, this'll be the day that I die. This'll be the day that I die.
How many of you recognize that song? What's the title?
American Pie.
American Pie. How many of you first heard this song playing on the radio? Okay, these are the old people among us, all right? What year was it? 1970. How long was the original song? Do you remember that?
57 years. It goes so long.
How long? Anybody know? Remember when they said it could not become a number one song because it was just too long and radio slots were not that long? I remember that. It was almost 9 minutes long.
See?
All right, so who wrote the poem and put it to music?
Don McLean.
Yeah. You know, McLean would never, ever talk about the meaning of his poem, although interviewers ask him dozens and dozens of times. All he would say is he wrote the poem because he believed things were headed in the wrong direction. In the late 1960s, life had become less ideal and less idyllic. American Pie recalls an airplane crash, February 3rd, 1959, in which musicians Buddy Holly and Ritchie Valli and J.P. the Big Bopper Richardson all died in this airplane crash. And that became known as the day the music died. Don McLean was 13 years old when he learned about Buddy Holly's death. He was actually folding newspapers for his morning newspaper route when he noticed the headline. Thus the line that you just listened to, "But February made me shiver with every paper I deliver, bad the day the music died." I saw some of you actually singing the words along with it. So one more question. If you were alive in that era, what came to your mind as you listened to that song? What images came to your mind? Just tell me. What?
Pie.
Pie? Yeah. What else? High school? Yep.
Vietnam.
Vietnam. What else?
Civil rights.
Riots in Berkeley, civil unrest. Some of you are don't want to say a girlfriend or a boyfriend's name. NASA, the moon landing, Apollo mission. If you are old enough, that song took you back. Just like that, didn't it? For me, it was high school basketball. It was training my dog team every day after basketball practice. Driving my dad's 1952 Willys in the wintertime without a heater and getting stuck in places that I shouldn't have been going in snowdrifts. There have been some modern redos of the song. Weird Al Yankovic did a parody in 1999. And in March 2000, Madonna did a much shorter version. But actually, short was the only positive thing most music critics could find to say about Madonna's attempt. Vicki and I last heard American Pie over at Ryan and Amy Jones' house a few weeks ago. We were there for dinner, and after dinner, Hayden picked up his guitar and played and sang the whole song. That's a tough song. Those are tough lyrics. He did great. But good poetry reaches into your soul and it stirs things that have been slumbering for a while. And the poem that Jesus gave to his disciples was meant to do just that. It had doctrines and it had values that they needed to be reminded of every day. It was designed to help carry the gospel forward as it left Jerusalem, went to Judea and Samaria and around the world. And sure enough, when the apostles took that gospel all around the Mediterranean world, they taught people the poem. They taught them the prayer because it was that important. And for 2,000 years, Christians have mimicked that. We have memorized and we've recited that poem just the way Jesus intended. I'd like us to read the passage, and then we're going to kind of break it down, look at the poetry. Flip your song sheet over, and on the back side is Matthew 6. I'd like you to stand if you're able. And we're going to read the Word of God. Matthew 6 is a very short passage. We're going to read verses 9 through 13. Let's read aloud together. Pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thank you. You may be seated. May God add his blessing to the reading of the gospel. But I don't want you to put the paper away. Keep the paper in your hand, unless you have your Bible open on another device or you brought your Bible. Because I want you to notice how verse 9 starts. Jesus said what? Pray then like this. Do you think Jesus meant that? I kind of think he meant it. Pray then like this. Pray these words. Jesus could have said, which you hear quite often, I'm going to give you a sample prayer and it contains the kinds of things that you should talk to God about. But I'm going to be honest with you. If you just copy my prayer, that's going to be vain repetition. You need to come up with your own words, put it in your own words, make it personal, and pray your own kind of prayer. Huh? You ever heard that? Uh-huh. Instead, he says, pray then like this. Because it's a really good prayer to pray. All too often, our prayers sound like the description that Anne Lamont offered in an essay she wrote. They go, thank you, thank you, thank you. Help me, forgive me, forgive me, forgive me. Jesus said, pray then like this. And what are the first two words? Our Father. You know, those words actually are a mouthful. Jesus does not say we should address God as the creator of the universe, although he was the creator of the universe. He does not tell us to pray to the Mighty One of Israel or to the Lion of Judah, although those are correct names for God as well. Jesus says, when you pray, say, Our Father. Now for us, it's like, okay, we do that. We've been doing that all our lives. Not so for Jesus' disciples. This was new. This was unusual. They had never heard this before. And not so for any of the other God followers in the time of Jesus. In the ancient Hebrew scriptures, God is called Father all through the Old Testament only 7 times. And every time God is called Father, he is the Father of Israel, Father of the nation. Not once does anyone call God their Father. So you think about what it was like for Abraham, Joseph, Esther, Ruth, David. They would never think of addressing God as Father. In fact, that probably would have felt blasphemous to them to do that. But in the New Testament, in the time of Jesus and after Jesus, 275 times in the New Testament, we're reminded that God is our Father, a personal God. The writer of Hebrews, in fact, is incredulous because he says, We actually have the privilege of walking boldly into the throne room of God. And here you are in this majestic throne room and you look up and you go, Dad? Dad? What does a good dad care about? Whatever's in the best interest of the child, of course. Whatever concerns you concerns the Father. Now, from those two words, our Father, the prayer divides into two sections. And the sections become evident if you look at the text and you look at the pronouns that are used. You may want to underline them or highlight them if you have the ability to do so in your Bible or device. The first section says 3 things about God. End of verse 9. I want you to underline the times that the word your, Y-O-U-R, shows. Hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done. Three times, your. This is about God. Now the section, in the second section, the pronoun switches to us. Again, three times, three different petitions. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts. Lead us not into temptation. So now I want to look at each of these phrases pretty briefly, beginning with the phrase, hallowed be your name. Now, when's the last time you used the word hallowed in speech? Probably you've only used it in reference to the Lord's Prayer. It's actually a good word. You can hear the root in it. It has the word holy in it. To hallow is to sanctify something, to set it apart, to make it holy. When we pray, hallowed be your name, we are affirming that God is preeminent in the universe. God is not a cuddly little teddy bear. He is not a senile great grandpa in the sky. He is a loving father, but he is also holy. He is perfect. He calls the shots. He runs the universe. Every day, he starts 350,000, every day he starts 350,000 hearts beating inside embryos. Every day, 350,000 hearts start beating. God does that. He sees you as an individual. He designed you inside your mother, and he has a unique purpose for your life. In Romans chapter 9, the Apostle Paul asked a rhetorical question. He said, who are you, a mere human being, to argue with God? Should the thing that has been created say to the one who created it, why have you made me like this? When a potter makes jars out of clay, doesn't he have a right to use the same lump of clay to make one jar for decoration and another to throw garbage into? I think that's New Living. I really like the way that says. Throw garbage into? We are all clay pots. Picture a clay pot. A whole bunch of 180 clay pots sitting on these chairs here. Now the clay pots, no two of them look alike. They're all different. But God loves every clay pot equally. And anybody who wants the best life possible has to start with God's purpose for that clay pot. Acts 13:36 is one of my very favorite scripture verses, maybe my favorite. It says, David served God's purpose in his generation, and then he died. That's what I want. I want to serve God's purpose in my generation. That's all. And if God wants me to be a trash can, I want to be the best trash can that I can. Now, some of you would not make very good trash cans. Some of you would fit much better in the china cabinet. I can't think of anything worse than being stuck in a china cabinet for a long time. I mean, my clay pot has got chips, it's been beaten up a little bit, it's kind of cracked, and some of you have been broken, and God has glued you back together and is using you. And other pots seem to have never lost their brand new glaze. And they go almost all the way through life, and the glaze is always there. You go, how could that be? Well, the reason it is the Creator decides. Hallowed be your name for choosing what to do with each clay pot. Your kingdom come is the second statement. As Henry Blackaby said, many of you studied his material back in the 90s, he said that our job is to find out where God is at work, what God is doing, and get on board. Get on board. Start supporting that. God is building his kingdom on earth. As Andrew said, Jesus said, go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them. Jesus said, when you pray, your kingdom come. When you do that, you are engaging in what God is doing in the spread of the gospel around the world. And something happens when you pray, your kingdom comes. What happens is you start thinking more about God's kingdom and how your little clay pot might be able to contribute to God's kingdom. So pray, your kingdom comes. Middle of verse 10 says, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Your will, God's will, not my will. Here's an interesting question. If God answered all of your prayers exactly the way you are asking, whose will would be done? Yours or God's? I don't know. It's just a question. Hopefully they're one and the same. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now verse 11 starts the second section, okay, where the pronoun switches, which Jesus lists three things for his followers to pray every day. Give us the food we need. Forgive us when we fall short. And deliver us from evil. Well, give us the food. You know that bread. He says pray every day for the daily bread. You know that bread has huge significance in the Middle East. You've known that for a long time. Now, all through the scriptures, bread symbolizes wholesome relationship, and to give bread and to share bread expresses acceptance and friendship and mutuality and genuine concern for other people. After Moses led God's people out of Egypt into the Sinai Desert, what was the big thing that God did for them every morning? What was the big thing? Bread, yeah, manna. Fresh bread. Imagine waking up every morning to that smell of fresh bread. I remember my grandmother Harrington's kitchen. She made bread and sold it out of her kitchen, just a tiny little kitchen. Thousands and thousands of homemade loaves of bread sold it in the community. I will never forget the smell of grandma's kitchen. It always smelled like bread, whether she was cooking bread or not. And for years, I've felt a little guilty praying this part of the prayer. Give us this day our daily bread, because like you, I'm guessing, I've never lacked more than a few hours. I've never lacked food for more than a few hours. But neither had Jesus' disciples. I mean, they lived in a subsistence culture. They got their fish out of the Sea of Galilee, and they were not in a dire situation at all. So why this phrase, give us this day our daily bread? The answer may be in the Greek word that is translated daily. It's a very interesting word because this is the only place this word appears anywhere in the Bible. And you know what? It doesn't appear anywhere in Greek literature. Nowhere. Only one other place. Archaeologists found the word on a papyrus fragment that was a grocery list, a shopping list. It's the only other place that they found the word. So based on that kind of scant, actually, contextual evidence, though, it seems that the word daily bread could mean today's bread, or it could mean tomorrow's bread. In fact, recent scholarship seems to lean toward the tomorrow's bread. So if that is correct, the prayer would literally read this way. Give us this day our bread for tomorrow. Give us today tomorrow's bread. That's a very different nuance, isn't it? We've always heard that we should only pray for your needs today, and you've heard lots of stories of how the old time people of great faith would ran this rescue mission or this orphanage, and they had no food, and not till an hour before lunchtime did some baker show up and say, I accidentally made three times too much bread. Here, will you take this bread, feed it to your orphans? Lots of stories like that of how God meets needs at the very last moment. But why would praying for tomorrow's bread be any less of faith? Jesus' point is not that your pantry shelves need to be bare every day, but that you should never take God's provision for granted. Even the provision that you're planning on eating tomorrow. If you pick corn today, you may eat some of it tomorrow. You can thank the Lord for the corn that you're going to eat tomorrow. Forgive us our debts is the next phrase. Verse 12 says. Oh, one other thing on prayer. But I think there's something about the bread thing, and that's that God wants us to pray about things as simple as a slice of bread. And also pray about big things, like the big decisions that you have to make tomorrow, the big choices. He wants us to live in daily dependence on Him. That's the daily part. Forgive us our debts, as we have forgiven our debtors, verse 12 says. Okay, so I'm quite sure he's not talking about student loans. In the 4th century, St. Augustine, he called this little phrase, forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors, he called it the terrible request. Because he says if a person prays, forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors, they are actually asking God not to forgive them if they are unforgiving themselves. Terrible request, he said. The idea was not new to the Jewish mind, to consciousness. There's a Jewish historical book in what's called the Apocrypha, called Ecclesiasticus. It was written many years before Christ. But Ecclesiasticus said, forgive your neighbor the wrong he has done, and then your sins will be pardoned when you pray. You remember the story that Jesus told of the man who was forgiven this huge debt. And then he goes out and he grabs somebody that owed him a couple bucks and grabs him by the throat and says, pay up right now. This very much displeased God. In a commentary that Jesus makes right after he gives the disciples this poem, Jesus said, if you do not forgive others, neither will the Father forgive you. That's pretty strong language. James, the half-brother of Jesus, kind of repeated the same idea when he wrote, judgment without mercy will be shown to the one who has not been merciful, in James 2:3. When John Wesley was a successful preacher in Great Britain in the 1700s, and then he felt like God wanted him to come to the American colonies to be a missionary in the American colonies, so he came to the U.S. for a couple of years. He came to the U.S. and he started out in Georgia, where he totally clashed with the governor of Georgia, whose name was Colonel James Oglethorpe. He wrote that the colonel was harsh and proud and brash. And at one time, the colonel boasted to Wesley when they're in this debate, he says, I never forgive and I never forget. To which Wesley replied, then sir, I hope you never sin. Because God does not look favorably on someone who refuses to forgive. But I want to give a little bit of a caution here. Because forgiveness, the word forgiveness is a huge word. And the process involved in forgiving can be very complex. When offenses aren't simple indiscretions or slights. Think about it. Forgiveness was not easy for God to pull off. It was so difficult that God started planning clear back in eternity past on how the Godhead was going to address how they were going to end up forgiving the human problem of sin. And the plan that the Trinity came up with involved the unthinkable, that one member of the Trinity would become human, take on human form and live and then sacrifice his life to pay the penalty for human sin. That's huge. And Jesus came and he did everything according to God's plan. He purchased forgiveness on the cross. But you know what? Not everyone is forgiven. Not everyone is forgiven. The penalty was paid, but and the sacrifice of Christ was all it took. But the forgiveness was not efficacious or was not effective except for those who do what? Who confess and repent and trust Christ as their Savior. Well, you just need to forgive and forget. I want to go, whoa, wait a minute. So in other words, what you're demanding is for me or for someone else to do more than God does for us, right? More than God does for us. Because God does not automatically forgive our sin just because Jesus died. His forgiveness is a process that involves two parties. When you contemplate how much God has forgiven you, it does make it much easier to extend grace to other people. But you may be right now in circumstances where you just feel like you've done everything you can and you can't forgive. You may feel stuck. You've tried to forgive and you've tried to resolve the situation as much as you can, but it hasn't worked. And you have to be very careful that in those circumstances, bitterness doesn't start eating the core out of your heart. I would just say this, if that is your situation, I'm really sorry. But I would encourage you to reach out for help. This is where a mature brother or sister in Christ or a Christian counselor can really help you unravel those things. Don't stay stuck by any means. And certainly don't just choose unforgiveness. People who have no desire to forgive, who wallow and revel in a wrong that's done, are not in a good spot, according to Jesus' poem. One benefit of praying, forgive us this our debts, as we forgive our debtors, is the fact that it forces you every day to keep pretty short accounts. It prompts us to every day examine our lives and see if there are things we need to ask God's forgiveness for. And it also reminds us to be forgiving people ourselves. You don't want to be the reason that reconciliation doesn't take place. The stakes are just too high. Now the final line in Jesus' poem is kind of a head-scratcher. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Wait a minute. Lead us not into temptation. That's a strange prayer. Why would a righteous God, why would you have to ask a righteous God, a holy God, to not lead you into temptation? Duh. Does God lead people into situations where they're going to be tempted and beyond what they're able, and then God punishes them if they give in to that temptation? This doesn't make any sense at all. The key to understanding is in the Greek word that's translated temptation. The Greek word can either mean enticing someone to sin, or it can mean testing the validity of someone's faith. The word occurs 21 times in the New Testament, and in 20 of those times, it means testing or putting something on trial, trying it. God never invites us to engage in sin, but God does put us in situations where our spiritual muscles get tested and we get tired and we may have to work at it to resist temptation. The idea is, Lord, keep me away from tests that would overpower me or sweep me away into sin. Keep me from temptations that I might not be able to resist. Years ago, a friend of mine helped me understand the difference between temptation and testing. He said, a test is given to you by someone who wants you to pass. Temptation is given to you by someone who wants you to fail. Jesus' ministry started with 40 days of temptation in the wilderness. Temptation and fasting. Temptation by Satan himself in the wilderness. And Jesus' victory over that temptation provides a great model for us. And it should encourage us, because we have exactly the same resources to resist Satan's temptation that Jesus had. Satan is a real adversary. We should never underestimate him. He is deceitful. He is very dangerous. But the request, lead us not into temptation, is really a request for God to let us see sin for what it really is. Show us, God, somehow show us let us see the consequences of sin before we do it. And so it will look as ugly to us as it does to you, God. Not less, there's one line that you might have wondered where was the line when we read the scripture passage together. The last line of the Lord's Prayer. You've always said, where is, for yours or for thine, is the kingdom and the power and glory forever and ever. Where is that? Where'd that come from? It's actually not in the Gospels. It's actually not in the Bible. You know that? Sometime in very early, in the first or second century, the church fathers, the leaders of the early churches, got together and they decided to add an addendum to the Lord's Prayer that said, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever, amen. And the reason they added it was that it sounded a little abrupt and strange for them, just for the prayer to end as, deliver us from evil. So they added that final phrase. If you read the Psalms, you see David doing that all the time. David will make these big grand statements and, you know, some kind of pour out his heart and pray that God would ruin somebody. And then at the very end, he'll add this, we call it a doxology. He'll add this little benediction and this little doxology to the end of the psalm that kind of makes it feel better as a prayer. That's what these early church fathers did. So it's not wrong to add that to the end of the prayer. It is certainly biblical. But just know, it is not inspired scripture. So Eric, I'm going to ask you and the music team to come back up and lead us in a couple songs. And if you're being baptized and you need to change, would you slip away right now and follow Yvonne? Ladies, follow Yvonne. Guys, you're on your own. Go find a bush. Slip out and get changed, because what we want to do when we get done singing this, these last couple songs, and then we're going to recite the Lord's Prayer together, we're going to go right into the baptism right after that. So, Eric, let's sing, okay?